the story of Usama, Usama ibn Zayd. So that one time, this man by the name of Hakim ibn Hizam, not a Muslim, came to the Prophet ﷺ and he gave him a gown, beautiful gown, and they said that gown one day belonged to Ziyazan, the mighty king of Yemen. Said the Prophet ﷺ accepted the gift and put it on. He said he got up and he was addressing the people. Hakim ibn Hizam, not a Muslim, said, I've not seen someone more beautiful, someone more handsome than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in that gown. But then he said, the next morning as I was walking in the alleys of Medina in the market, I saw Usama ibn Zayd wearing the same gown that yesterday I gave to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that one day belonged to Ziyazan, the mighty king of Yemen. When the scholars of Sirah describe Usama, they say, وَكَانَ أُسَامَةُ دَنِيمًا. Usama, they say, was an ugly man. Extremely dark, had very deep eyes, very flat nose, and very thick lips. Now, this is not to say this is what determines, you know, whether someone is beautiful or ugly. But to the culture back then, this was their understanding of what ugly is or what, you know, beautiful is. In some places in Africa, you know, the bigger your lips, the more beautiful you are. In fact, in Africa, in many parts of Africa, the bigger the person is, the more beautiful they are. Okay? So don't confuse this with, you know, that a person is putting. It's just how it was understood back then. So Hakim ibn Hizam, non-Muslim then, looks into Usama ibn Zayd wearing that, you know, gown that one day belonged to Ziyazan, and he looks at him, you know, from head to toe, and he goes, Anta ya Usama? Said, you Usama, you are wearing the gown that one day belonged to Ziyazan, the mighty king of Yemen? I mean, such an honor to you, slave, or former slave, or your father being former slave, not looking dark. What does Usama say? Oh, I'm really sorry, I know I shouldn't have done it, but, you know, I happened to be passing by, and the Prophet gave it. He did not apologize for this. He looked right at him and he said, Wallahi inni khayrun min Ziyazan. He said, by Allah, I am better than Ziyazan. Wallahi inna ummi khayrun min ummi. And by Allah, my mother is better than his mother. Wallahi inna abi khayrun min abiha. And by Allah, my father is better than his father. Why did he say this? He said, for my family and I say la ilaha illallah, but Ziyazan and his family never said la ilaha illallah. Meaning that he knew where his self-value, his self-worth comes from. You know, where we come from does not define who we are. That would be silly. To say that where I come from defines who I am. Our positions, our possessions do not define who we are. And that would be a very silly way of wanting to define yourself. What is the difference between you and the buff boy, man, or the very slim looking girl that wants to make a statement with her body? What's the difference between you and them saying that, you know, I come from there, therefore I must be so and so. So we see that this does not say anything about us. You look into people like Ubad ibn Samit. He is invited by the emperor. He goes, you know, I want someone to come and speak to me. You know, who are these Muslims? He's invited and he comes on his horse. And they say, you know, you cannot talk to our emperor while riding your horse. He said, people, you invited me. I come the way I want. You do not tell me what to do. If he wants to talk to me this way, mashallah. If he does not, then mashallah again. And he starts turning back. He goes, no, just have him come in the way he wants. He comes to him and goes, what brings you here? What brings you here, Muslims? Do you want money? You're looking, what is it that you're looking for? He looks at him and said, جِئْنَا لِنُخْرِجَ الْعِبَادِ. He said, we come to take the creation, the servants of Allah, out of serving other creation to the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We come to take them out of the injustices of their own religion to the justice of Islam. We come to take them out of the narrowness of this life to the vastness of this life and the hereafter. Extreme self-respect. He really knows what his mission is and is able to very eloquently share it with us. You know, subhanAllah, what's so interesting about this statement? That Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never said it. But Ubad ibn Samit, being a student of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he concluded, this is these are the implications of being a Muslim. That you worship none but Allah. That you have an obligation towards humanity. That you free them. You liberate them. That this life may be very narrow to them, but you take them, as you have been taken out through Islam, from the narrowness of this life to the vastness of this life and the vastness of the hereafter as well. So we see this happening nowadays with the Muslim community where our self-image psychology has really been traumatized by what is taking place. Seeing people changing names. Wallahi, people came to me in the masjid and they said, is it haram to change my name? They came in and they really changed their name. Now the issue is not about halal and haram. The issue is much deeper than this. This is not to discount the fact that it's halal or haram, but the issue is much deeper than this. These people are no longer comfortable with who they are. They are not. So now they're looking for comfort as society will give it to them. So now the name Bilal does not sound good, so call them Billy. Or Muhammad does not sound good, so call them Mo. You know? Or maybe Aisha does not call Queen Latifah. You know? Or maybe just change the name. So that you get your approval from society. SubhanAllah, you know, it's going back to the issue of the making a statement with your body, because your body is supposed to be making a statement about you. And I say to myself, SubhanAllah, what about the kid with the acne all over his face? He's not supposed to be feeling good? What about the kid that is big? He's not supposed to be feeling good? What about the girl that does not look very good? She's not supposed to be feeling good about herself? Hey, what about the kid that really looks very good today and buff, but tomorrow he has an accident? Are we saying that he must stop feeling good about themselves? Because now they no longer have the approval of the society, or they do not fit the criterion that was created for them by the society? Said who? But in Islam we are taught that we'll be in contentment with the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created us. Not only that, you do not use your physical appearance to make a statement about yourself, but you use your physical appearance for mastering skills and for pleasure. And subhanAllah, this is so fair because all are capable of it. Mastering skills for mastery and for pleasure. It's all fair game for everyone. Allah subhanAllah, beauty is beautiful, mashaAllah. Nothing, you know, this is not to discount beauty. But to say that the people who are entitled to feel good about themselves are only beautiful people, I'm afraid that many people in the world are going to be depressed. I won't be. Get it? Okay. So now that is the issue. To us as a Muslim community now, we being defamed. Not only that, but even Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is being called names. Pedophile, this, you know, wicked man, had 9 women, womanizer, and these are names that are being, you know, people come to them and says, is it true that Muhammad really had 9 women? Well, yeah. Oh my God. What do we tell people now? Okay, so to them it was such a catastrophe. What do we tell people now? Well, I have a question. Who set them people to be the reference point to begin with? Who said that they are the reference point? Who put them as a judge? So I'm speaking of this. The ever-changing Western culture can never be a reference point. I gave the example yesterday of Indian women wearing the sari that shows your belly button. When Westerners would look into Indian women's in the 1940s and 50s, they go, oh, how uncivilized that is. How rude that is. How bad that is. Why are these women doing this to themselves, showing their belly button going around? Isn't this today the fashion today? Go anywhere on any campus, this is what you see. Women showing their belly buttons all the time. Now the question is, what part of your civilization or culture are we going to take as the reference point? Is really bad? Said who is really bad? Okay. So we see this happening and somehow we gave them the moral leadership in telling us what is right and what is wrong. So people are feeling bad about this as well. So we see this happening as well. And like I said, you know, every one of us is a terrorist. Not only that, but they tell us that from now on, every masjid is, you know, informants will be coming in because every masjid is a potential sleeping cell. So now all of you people here are potential terrorists, and we must be keeping an eye on you. And this is not something that I'm making up. This is something that they've said, you know, the FBI has said. In fact, about 3 months ago, they had a meeting with the leaders in the Washington, Virginia area, and they said, you know, come for a meeting with the FBI, and please, if you can, also bring the record of your membership with you.